Back in June 2013, I reviewed the Contour Roam 2 action camera. Now, I really liked the camera, but in the intervening period, the company went bankrupt. But recently, it's risen like a phoenix from the flames and brought with it the new Contour Roam 3 camera. Now, it looks just like a little bit of a retooling of the previous model, but I'm happy to say that one of the issues that I had with the Roam 2, which was its terrible low light performance, has been resolved, or improved upon a great deal anyway, with the Roam 3. So there's definitely some improvements in this new model, so let's have a proper look at it in a little bit more detail to see what else has happened. Now, I use a Roam 2 on my motorcycle helmet because I just can't bring myself to wear a silly box on the top of it. It just looks ridiculous to me and embarrassing. A Roam camera, on the other hand, slides neatly on the side of the helmet. It achieves this feat by using a clever rail mounting system on either side of the camera. Now, most action cameras have a mounting system on the base of them. With this having it on the side, it means you can slide it on the side of a motorcycle or a bicycle helmet onto its purpose-made mount, which cleverly molds itself to the shape of the helmet. And then you can rotate the lens on the camera to get the horizon perfectly straight. To assist you in doing this, it's got a laser leveling system. You can operate the big button on the top, which both switches it on and starts recording whilst wearing big chunky motorcycle gloves. The camera itself is waterproof to 10 meters. So really, as far as helmet cameras go, they've really got it sorted. Right, let's go through this. Now, the Roam 3, of course, is the latest camera from the Contour people, but they're still selling the 2 Plus model, which is actually a little bit higher spec than the Roam 3. I know it's a bit confusing, but let's go through this one anyway. Notice waterproof to 10 meters, 170 degree wide angle lens on there. There's some other specs that you can see on the screen, but I'll go through most of these things during the course of the video. There's the camera inside the box behind a little clear section. We'll just slide everything out and go through these things one at a time. So there it is, all nicely laid out. First off, of course, let's just have a quick look. We've got the camera there, and notice it's got this rubber lens cap on there that I'm immediately going to lose. Nice little bag to put it in there. USB A to mini B rather than the more common nowadays micro B. 8 gig micro SD card, only a class 4 with an adapter. Little sticker there, which is going in the bin. There's a mount, which is the rotating mount. Now, look, quite clever on this one. You can rotate it, but when you push this little bit in here at the bottom, it locks it in place. So that way you can get the camera on something, rotate it to the exact position you want, and then just lock it in that position as well. There's a spare adhesive mount for that one. There's only one of these in the box. You can get spares, of course. This is the one that goes on the motorcycle helmet or bike helmet or whatever. Notice it's flexible as well. It's kind of rubberized around the edges, so you can bend it and mold it to the shape of the helmet, but the plastic bit in the middle is hard. So the idea is it molds itself to the helmet, but that bit remains firm and keeps the camera nice and steady. Basically, the whole thing revolves around this. This is the most important thing in the box to me. And then, of course, we've got a little lanyard to attach to the camera, stop it falling off things if it loses the connection with the mount somehow. That goes through a little hole there on the back of the camera, and it will attach to that rotating mount I showed you. There's a little eyelet hole on there, but there isn't one on the kind of flat helmet mount thing, which is a bit strange. They could perhaps do with putting a little eyelet hole on that. Now, there's the rail mounting system I mentioned. I'll just show you how it attaches to one of these mounts. So we'll use that rotating one. Notice we've got these sort of 2 rails on here, which go into the bottom of the camera there, slides in from the back towards the front, and it just pushes in like this. Once it's on there, it doesn't tend to fall out. It never has done with me anyway. And the way that happens is because there's these little raised sections here, you might be able to see them there, which correspond with these little dimples inside the rail. So it holds itself in place. Right, we'll have a proper look around the camera. You can see below the lens there, it says it's 10 meters waterproof, which is an improvement on the previous Roam 2 model. There's the big rubberized switch on the top, easy to operate whilst wearing a glove, and you can lock it in either the off or the on position by sliding that switch across on the top of it. Now, the lens can be rotated up to 180 degrees in either direction. As you twist the lens around, you can feel it clicking into certain positions at 45, 90, 180 degrees. So you can tell exactly where the lens is just by feeling it, but also by looking at those little dots on the top as well, so you know when you've got the lens upside down or the right way around. And it's very important having a rotating lens like that on a camera, because when you have a camera slightly at an angle on a motorcycle helmet, which they always are, they're just usually just below the centre of a helmet and they're at this angle, you do need to rotate the lens round so that you can still keep the horizon straight. Without that feature, a helmet camera is very difficult to get mounted properly. Now we'll just have a look around the rest of the camera. So in the back here, there's a little door that pops down. You lift it up and it springs down on a spring-loaded mechanism. Now inside there, you can see I've got the USB charging data transfer socket. There's a little button that pushes through from the back, which is to operate the laser mechanism. We've got a switch on the right here that says 1 or 2 on it. And I'll put the micro SD card in. Notice there's a little picture to say which way up it goes. So you just push it in there. It has to go quite a long way down. It does click into place in the spring-loaded slot. Now notice that little tiny format button at the bottom. That's very handy. You get a card and you want to format it in the camera, of course, not in your computer. So you put it in there, hold that down for a few seconds. The camera will beep. Little yellow light flashes on the picture of a memory card and green means it's ready to go. So that's how easy it is to format a card inside this camera. The back of the door there, you can see it's a little bit rubberized. Of course, that's to keep it waterproof. And once you close it, you can lock that door in position to stop it popping open by sliding that little switch across there. Now, I'll just show you the camera in operation. It's very simple. To switch it on and start recording, you just slide the big switch from the back to the front position. The camera will beep. There'll be indicator lights come on to tell you that the battery's fine and there's a memory card in it. And that red light shows at the back and also on the front below the lens, where you can also see the tiny hole where the microphone is. It will get some wind noise, I'd imagine, in that position, whatever you do. Now you can lock the camera in the on position, as I mentioned, by sliding that little switch across there, which is quite handy. It means you won't accidentally switch it off if you're doing something particularly energetic where it might get knocked. But of course, if you want to switch it off, just slide it back and then slide the camera to the back position. It'll stop recording and it'll turn the camera off at the same time as well. Now, you can also operate a laser on the camera, which will help you line it up properly. To do that, press the button on the back in the middle briefly, and that turns the laser on. It'll do this whether the camera's on or off. As you can see here, the laser's come on, so I can now line it up on my hand by just twisting that middle bit there and just get the camera exactly how you want. I'll show you that a little bit more later, just before the sample clips. It automatically switches off after a few seconds. Now, on the Console 3, they've added a new feature. If you hold down that button on the back for a couple of seconds, as well as switching the laser on, it also now goes into photo mode. Notice the picture of a camera there in green, and every time I press that button on the back now, it'll take a photo, or a still, 5-megapixel still. If you want to switch it off, hold it down, and then the camera goes back off again. Now, I've mentioned the Roam 2 a few times, so let's have a look how it compares to the Roam 3. So that's a 2 on the left and a 3 on the right. You can see below the lens, it tells you what the model is. Again, 2 on left, 3 on right. Now let's have a look around the rest of the camera to see what other differences you got. Well, the indicator light seems a little bit different on the newer model. Also, the tripod hole on the new one also has one of those locator holes next to it. That's very handy because it means it won't rotate when you put it on a tripod screw mount, as long as it's got the right locator type mechanism. Now, the previous model, the 2, had this kind of 90 degrees thing and 180 degrees marks around the lens, whereas the new one's a little bit subtler. It's just got these little indents in the metal, as well as those two white dots on the front of it. Now, around the back of the cameras, the older 2 model says status below that middle button. And if you look at the top, the coating on the rubberized button is slightly different between the two cameras, a bit more knobbly perhaps on the new one. The lock switch on the top of the 2 sticks up a little bit from the top of the rubberized switch, and therefore it's easier to operate than the one on the 3, which is flush with the top of the switch and means you really have to get a fingernail in there if you want to flip that across, and it's a much firmer movement to it as well. I actually prefer the one on the 2. Now, if you look at the back of the camera, you see I've got an extra indicator light on the right hand side for the photo mode I showed you before. Now, if you get inside the back of both of these cameras, they're pretty similar. There's just one difference between them, and that's the 3, which is the one on the right, has the 2-position switch on the right-hand side at the top. And that switch is actually very handy once you get into the software settings, so I'll show you that now. The first step is to attach the camera up to your computer using the supplied USB lead. Now, you've got to have a memory card in the camera, of course, but then it will show up as an external storage device. On there, you'll find a URL. So if you click on there, that takes you through to the Contour website and the appropriate page for your camera, where you can download a piece of software called Storyteller that's available for Mac or Windows. Now, you don't necessarily need this for copying files across. This is what I'm showing you now, though. You've got all the files on the right-hand side of the stored on the memory card inside the camera, and you can click on any one of these. But if you want to play them back or do anything with them, you've got to import them into the computer. So you can select one or all of them and just import them like this. Now, all this does is copy it across to your hard drive, something you could do straight off the memory card if you want. You don't have to use this piece of software to do things like this. If you are using this piece of software, you've got an option there to delete the things on the camera if you want, best leaving them on there. But you can see I can play this video file back on the screen here in the Storyteller software. You got a few little options in here. I can make it full screen if I want. You can also jump around the video, of course, to different sections of it. And then there's something like you can adjust the speed, you can play it back in slow motion if you want, and you can do a thing called awesome, it says in the middle there, which I think the awesome thing is perhaps really just bookmarking a particular section out of the video that's you think's worth looking at. Because these files can get up to 4 gigs in size, which is quite a bit of time. So you might want to just mark a particular section out of that video as being of relevance. Now, if you want, you can then upload the file straight to YouTube, straight from this piece of software. I probably wouldn't recommend that. I think you need to edit it a bit first, probably. Now, this is the most important thing, this little tiny cog at the top left here, next to the name of the camera. That gets into the settings screen. You can see at the top right there, that's the memory card I've got in. I swapped it around for one of my bigger ones. That's the firmware on there. You can rename the camera, and you can also change it between PAL and NTSC frame rates. And then this is your two position switch options here. I've got position one, position two. You can have different things set in each position. So position one, I can have a 1080p 30, which is what I did, by the way. And then position two, I could have a 720p 60. And you can change a lot of settings as well as just the frame rates and things. You can change the quality, low, medium and high. I've done everything in high that you'll see in this review. This section along the bottom here is very handy. It gives you some information about how the settings that you're changing will affect the video. For example, look at the right here, field of view 125 degrees. That's for the 1080p mode at the top. If I change that into a 720p mode, notice it's gone up to a 170 degree field of view. Now, you've also got some other things here. You can change the white balance depending on the type of conditions that you're going to be out in, whether it's dusk, daylight, cloudy, all that kind of stuff. And then in this mode here, you can change the audio. You can have the beep for the camera on or off, and also you can adjust the microphone sensitivity. For example, if I'm going out on the motorbike, I'm driving into wind, it's going to be very noisy, a lot of wind noise. Might want to adjust that all the way down just to reduce the volume level on the soundtrack. Now, lighting, you could play with this all day long. You've got quite a few different things here. For example, your metering could be center, average or spot. For the video that I'm going to show you later, I did it on center, but maybe I should have done it average. It's the kind of thing you could play around with quite a lot. And then some other settings here where you can manually adjust the different things for contrast and brightness and exposure, but you can also have the camera use a few of its presets. And that's perhaps one of the issues with this camera, that you could change things a little bit too much perhaps, and it won't do things completely automatic, and you're going to have to do a lot of trial and error. You can have the lights on the camera on or off, and you can also have the laser on or off. And then that's just position one. You can go into position two then and change everything all over again. So you've got two different things in the different settings. For example, when I was out on the bike, I had 1080p 30 in position one, 720p 60 in position two. And that's how I was able to go out on one journey and try a few different things out. Well, two different things. But again, remember, you have to come back home, attach it up to a computer if you want to change things again. So a lot of times you might get things just wrong, and you've got to go back to your computer before you can change them again, which is a little bit of a downside to this camera, I think. Now, as far as stats go, let's go through a few things here. The video format MP4, it's an AVC1 variable bitrate codec. Now, the bitrates, looking at my files, 1080p 30, the maximum I got was 18.6 megabits a second, and 720p 60 was 16.1 megabits a second. Those are all right, those megabits. Records in 4 gigabyte chunks. If you leave it recording, you'll get a 4 gigabyte file, which is the maximum the FAT file format will handle, and that's circa 30 minutes of 1080p 30 video with the high quality settings. The stills are 1944x2592, which is also known as 5 megapixel. Battery life is supposed to be up to 3.5 hours. I only got 2 hours 45 in one of my tests, but I haven't really done an awful lot of battery tests, so maybe it will go up over time. And in a vain, but ultimately futile attempt to preempt some of the more predictable questions, no, you can't overlay a timestamp on the video, and no, the camera doesn't loop or recycle a video once the memory card's full. In fact, I'm pretty sure it doesn't do anything that I'm not going to show you during the course of this video. Now we've got all that out of the way, I'm going to show you some sample clips from the camera. Remember, YouTube negatively affects the quality of these clips, and that's the reason I have downloadable samples available, and you can get those from the link in the video description. Now the first shot I'm showing you here is really just to show you the field of view of the camera in a recognisable location. You'll see this in my other videos as well. So notice what you can see on the left and right of the image, and top and bottom as well. I've got the camera at a slight angle, I think I've got the lens twisted a little bit, but ignore that. Now let's move over into 720p 60 and have a look at that. You can see you've got quite a lot more in shot here. That's the 170 degrees field of view in 720p compared to the 125 degrees in the 1080p mode. Now I'll show you that clip that I showed you right at the beginning of the video again inside the Printworks, just to give you an idea, full screen, so it's not split down the middle this time, of how it performs in a low light environment like the enclosed Printworks in Manchester, which is quite dark. It's not the best performance I've ever seen in here. It's respectable. That's about all I'll say about it, but it's not blinding. Now, looking outside here, I'll just do a bit of a spin round to give you an idea what that field of view looks like and how much fisheye effect you get in shot. It's not too bad actually, 125 degrees, not too much barrel distortion. This camera doesn't have a built-in stabilizer, so you can see a bit wobbly when I'm walking along, but a camera like this isn't really designed for walking around with. It's more of a helmet camera. Let's have a listen to some audio for a second. So the sound quality is adequate. It's not amazing, but it's good enough. And to be honest, when you're driving along on a bike, you're just going to get wind noise in the microphone anyway, so it doesn't really matter. Now let's just have a look at this shot, but taken as a photo, as a still. So this is a 4:3 still taken with the camera on the same spot. I've zoomed in on that. That's a crop section out of the middle. Let's have a look at the video again, and then we'll crop a section out of that, and then we'll compare those side by side to see if it really does have a 5 megapixel sensor. Well, there's not much in it, but I do think the photo does have a little bit more detail in it compared to the video. So yes, maybe this really does have a 5 megapixel sensor for photos. Now, it's unlikely anyone's going to buy this camera to use it as a still camera, but it's nice to know it does it anyway, and they're not bad at all, and they don't have any blurring on them, and it's quite responsive to take a picture. One other thing you can do with them, though, that might be more useful is this continuous photo mode. I've put that into position 2 on my camera, and in continuous photo mode, you can have the camera automatically take a picture at those predetermined intervals you see in that drop-down box there. All those stills then go into a folder on your camera. As you can see here, I've got a big long list of those. I've put those into a time-lapse assembler program, and I've created a video like this. I put the camera in my car windscreen, and it took a photo, I think it was every 5 seconds or so, to get this video. Now, this would be a great way for someone to condense a cross-country journey on their motorcycle to just a few minutes in length. However, there is an issue. The files are created with the file names of 1 to 999. And then when it gets up to there, it creates a new folder and starts back at number 1 again. Now, anyone that knows anything about assembling time-lapse, this isn't a good idea, because you've only got a few files, you've got to create a time-lapse out of those, and then you've got to create a few more files into a time-lapse, or perhaps rename them all. It's just a nuisance. It's a pity they didn't have a larger number range. Now, being a helmet camera, it's only right I should take it out on my motorcycle helmet. Now, I'm going to put the 2 on one side, I'm going to put the 3 on the other so we can compare the video. I've got a mount already on the motorcycle helmet, and I'm going to remove that using dental floss. Now, I've seen someone mention before that this doesn't work very well. It does, you're just using the wrong stuff. You need to use a really nasty, horrible dental floss that you would never use on your teeth. The kind that will cut off the blood supply in your finger before it snaps, not the nice soft stuff that's not going to cut into your gums. And once you've got that, saw it back and forth, and that will cut through the gluey mount on the back of a piece of plastic, because I need to remove this one. This was off a different camera before I've got the space to put the contour on there. So now I've got one on one side, I just need to put the other one on this side. Unfortunately, I can't really mount it the right way around, but it will work this way around as well. Just get it at the right angle, approximately the same angle as the other one. Push it on there. The adhesive curves to the helmet, and that's the big thing with a contour mount. It curves to the contours of the motorcycle helmet, meaning it gets a really good firm attack. And then you just slide the camera on there like that. So now I've got the Contour 3 on the left hand side of the helmet, and the old Contour 2 is on the right. Now I'm inside my garage, this is a view from the Contour 3, and I need to line the cameras up. So I've switched both lasers on, notice they're a bit off center, so I've got to twist around those lenses on the front. I'm going to try and get the lasers in line with the brickwork on the wall here so that it's nice and straight, the horizon straight. So that's perfect, then the lasers switch themselves off. Notice the 3 though, I've mounted a little bit higher angle than the 2. And unfortunately I think that's affected the video quality slightly. The contour range has never had blinding video quality. It's really more about the mounts. It's good enough, but it's never really knocked the socks off people. And I think the same goes for this. This is the 2 on the right, the 3 on the left. And there isn't an awful lot in it. It's not like twice as good or anything like that. It looks pretty much the same. Now the Contour 2 has a lower bit rate than the Contour 3. The 3 goes up to, was it 18.5 I mentioned before? And the 2 only goes up to something like 14.5. So there should be more detail in each shot, and it should help in things like when you're driving under or riding under trees and you get that kind of shadow and there's a lot of detail going on. That's the kind of time when a video would tend to block up. You get a lot of artifacts on the screen, mosaicing as it's sometimes called. Now YouTube tends to add that into any video that I upload. So as I mentioned before, if you want to download the real samples from this camera, I've got a link in the video description. You can go in there and try it out for yourself, because it'll definitely look better than it does on YouTube. Now let's bring the Contour 2 in from the right here. As you can see, it looks pretty similar. I think you're going to get some differences because of the way the light's hitting the camera, the angle of the camera. Also, because the 3 is pointing a little bit higher up, we're getting more sky in on that one, and maybe that's affecting the exposure levels for the ground, whereas the 2 is at a bit of a better angle. In fact, you know, when I'm going to use this properly, I'm going to put the 3 on the right hand side permanently. Now let's just do a bit of a freeze frame on a sign down here, because I want to see what the difference in quality was. So let's just go back a second, because there was a little sign back there. I just want to freeze on it and we can have a look. So that's what the Contour 3 looks at on this little sign. That's the Contour 2. You can see the different sides of the helmet. If I zoom in a little bit, that's the 3, and then we'll switch across to the 2. Looks pretty much the same, doesn't it? There's not much in it. I might be a frame difference in the video there, so you never know. I might be a little bit nearer with one than the other, but there isn't a massive amount of difference between the two cameras. Now, one thing I did notice when I was riding into the sun, which is what's happening here, things got much too dark as far as the exposure goes. Now, I did have the exposure set to center metering. Maybe average would have been better, or spot, or perhaps if the camera was pointed slightly lower down, it might improve things a little bit. There's no way really to tell. You could keep going back home, changing the settings, coming back out, but by then the light shifted. And that's possibly one of the issues with this camera, that you could keep fiddling about forever, just trying to get the settings just perfect. Now, what you're looking at here is the 170 degree 720p 60 mode. Now, you're not going to be able to see it in 60 frames a second on YouTube, so I'm going to put some downloadable samples up so you can download this particular scene. But you can see it's the 170 degree mode because the visor on the right, you can see more of that, and also the buildings are curving in more. We're getting more barrel distortion, more fisheye effect, but on the positive side, you're getting more in shot. Back to 1080p 30 again. Now, in my opinion, the Contour Roam isn't really a typical kind of action camera that you attach to all sorts of things and shoot crazy videos and upload them to YouTube. I think it's more of a workman-like tool. You'd attach it to your bicycle or motorcycle helmet and you commute to work whilst you've got it on every day. And after a few days, if nothing's happened, you press the format button, delete the footage on the card, and start all over again. Of course, you probably have to charge it at your desk or whatever when you get to work or when you get home in the evening. But use it more as a car DVR, as a dash cam, so that if anything happened, any incident, you've got a video recording of what's going on. But it's certainly not really the kind of camera I think that you're going to record your crazy antics and share it with your zany friends. I think it's more serious than that. Now, if it is going to perform as a commuter camera or a dash cam for motorcyclists, it's going to have to perform well in low light, because a lot of cycling or motorcycling to work is done in the dark, unfortunately. Now, this is what it looks like in the car. I put both the 2 and the 3 side by side, and to be honest, I'm not that impressed. Earlier on, I thought it would resolve the low light problems. It looked okay in the print works, but out on the road it just seems too dark, and this is with the settings set for the low light. You can see on the right, the Contour 2, how dark that was. Contour 3, definitely an improvement on that, but I've bought dash cams over the last year that cost perhaps a quarter or a fifth of the price of this camera that give a much better low light performance than this. It feels very much like the Contour 3 is still using old technology. Maybe when they brought the company back, they didn't have the money to invest in new technology and we're still using sensors from 12 months or so ago. So really, I'm not impressed enough with the low light capabilities of this camera to recommend that people get it if they're going to be commuting in the dark. Things just seem a little bit gloomy for me here. Now, one positive feature of the camera is that it's waterproof. So we'll test that now. Now, I'm not a diving kind of guy. People always want me to go diving. I hate messing around in water. So this is as good as you're going to get. I'll just stick it inside a bucket of water. Notice one thing, it doesn't float. I mean, the camera has got a metal body on it and it's quite a weighty device, and therefore it just sinks straight to the bottom. But I'm not going to go diving with this. I think this is more for putting on a motorcycle helmet and it starts raining. It's not going to break the camera. And you don't need to put a separate waterproof case on it either. So talking of weights, let's just have a look exactly how much this camera weighs. So it's 155 grams, which is 5.5 ounces approximately. I'm glad that Contour resurrected itself, but the Contour 3 is really pretty much just a retooling of the two with a few little tweaks. The thing that still sells a Contour to me is its mounting system. This little tiny piece of rubber, the way it curves to the contours of a helmet, enables you to wear a helmet camera on the side and get it pointing in the right direction. That's the thing that sells it. The performance of the camera still leaves quite a little bit to be desired. Now, if you want to get hold of one of these, there's links to buy in the video description, and there's also downloadable samples up there. Now, I'm still going to use the Contour Roam 3 because I still think it's the best helmet camera for me at the moment, but I just wish it was a little bit better. Anyway, that's it for the moment. As always, thanks for watching.